I hate to think what would have happened had Billie Jean lost. Because we knew what had happened when Margaret lost. Billie Jean had to go and play Bobby Riggs and do the job that needed to be done, because at that time, it was the 70s, we were fighting for equality, equal pay, recognition, women's lib. So it was very, very important that we win that match, and it changed so many things for women, not only in sports or tennis, in the workforce, probably at home as well. I'm sure I heard stories about, bets at home, the wife and the husband betting that if one wins, that they'll have to do the laundry and cooking and all that. And I assure you, Bobby Riggs was doing the same thing. Laundry, cooking, and all the stuff that he said women should do, he was doing. So anyway, it was a wonderful moment. And I think having the movie come 43 years later, it doesn't matter, it was meant to happen. I think it was a great honor. I think, great pride to be one of the original nine. And these original nine women took the dollar and went against the establishment and said, look, we want to be paid equal money. Well, obviously in the 70s, we all know for those, who are old enough that women really didn't belong in sports or didn't have the opportunity to have a career in sports. So, Title IX in 1972 allowed that to happen, where if you were a woman, you could pursue a career in sports. So, so many things happened. And of course, the movie has some creative liberties. In 1970, we started the Virginia Slims. That's when we first broke away from the Pacific Coast, which was Jack Kramer's tournament. So we went to Houston. Gladys Heldman, fortunately, had a great contact, the CEO at Virginia Slims, Coleman. And he said, we will put up the prize money for the women. So nine women showed up, we needed 16, another, four or five came around, and we started our Houston tournament, which was the first tournament for Virginia Slims, and I happened to have won that, so. So I was the first to win. I think it was about $1,700, which was $300 more than what Jack Kramer paid Stan Smith, who won the Pacific Coast. So I made more than he paid the Mets. So that made me very, very happy. I'm going to open this up to, yes?
Was Jack Kramer really that bad a guy?
Well, at that time he was. He was. He did not think much of women or women's tennis. And he was very strong. When we went to him and asked him, would he please give us equal prize money? The ratio was really 10 to 1. He said, I don't need the women. I don't care what you do. You can go ahead and play your own tournament, do whatever you want to do. But, I am not giving you that prize money. And fortunately for us, it really made us go elsewhere and fight the establishment. And so that's how we started with women's professional tennis, because it never existed before that. And open tennis came into the picture in 1968 when Wimbledon decided that they wanted to have open tennis. So that meant amateurs and pros together. Anybody else?
Rosie, did you encounter different types of sexism in different parts of the country?
What did I encounter?
For example, it's more racist. A particular tribe is more racist in the South.
Yeah.
Did you encounter more sexism in different parts of the country?
That's a good question, but I don't remember necessarily. I think that we were experiencing, you know, the fact that we were women in sports, and, you know, people that believe that women should not be in sports would make comments like, why are you playing? Why, you know, you're earning a living. Why aren't you married? Why aren't you, you know, having children? Why aren't you home? And I think we had that pretty much across, you know, the board, you know, all over the states that we played. And there were a lot of supporters also. Because, as I said, it was a great time. The 70s was a great time. I was young. We were, you know, not afraid of what was happening, and, you know, we were willing to risk our careers to you know, fight for what we believe. So a lot of things were happening in the 70s. Yes?
The pendulum's returned on so many levels of social change. Has that affected the movement for women to continue having equal pay in sports and getting into the field?
Well, I think we have a long way to go, and I keep saying that I hope that this young generation sees the movie and realizes that we have not finished fighting the battles. I mean, women are still second-class citizens, and we still don't have a woman president. So
yes.
I'm wondering about that. We've had prime ministers, women everywhere, but not in the United States, and I really feel that we need to do better than what we've done. We need to get united and still keep fighting the fight, because it's not over. And you know, I keep making reference to Billie Jean making the comment that women get 79 cents to the dollar. You know, a man gets a dollar, they get 79 cents, so maybe we should only do 79% of the work and take the rest of the time off. So I thought that was pretty good, but, you know, I think a lot more has to be done. I think, you know, we've been a little bit dormant. We you know, I think the 70s was not a dormant time. You know, we went from the Vietnam War and protesting, and, you know, Cal Berkeley always protesting. I mean, they still do protesting there right now, but I think that we need to do, as women, we need to do more. And this younger generation, I think, at least I think for the tennis players, they've gotten very complacent. You know, Sloan Stephen wins $3.7 million. Wow. You know, that wouldn't have happened. And that would not have happened if the original nine wouldn't have signed the contract with Gladys and taken a chance and bought the establishment. So there's still lots of work to do. Yes?
You said at the time of the Battle of the Sexes, Jeff Boone was a bad guy. Did he come around?
Oh, yeah, he finally came around. You know, we became friendly, and, you know, he said, well, I guess I was wrong. I said, yes, you were wrong. And, but, you know, again, we have to think about the times. That was, you know, the times.
Did he promote women?
What's that?
Did he promote women? Or did
he tried to promote in his way, you know, but as he got older, obviously, he did not have the platform he used to have by having the tournament, having television, and after a while, he wasn't doing that. But during the 70s, he wasn't for women.
Did you play tennis with him?
Did I play tennis with him? I'll tell you, I met him when I was about 9 years old at Golden Gate Park. He came out with his pros of Ken Rosewall and Rod Laver, and he gave a clinic, a free clinic to all the kids out of Golden Gate Park, and that's how I came to know Jack Kramer. And, you know,
but when you were an adult,
when I was an adult, I played this tournament. I used to play the Pacific Southwest in Los Angeles.
Did you ever play him?
No, he was much older than I. When I was about 20, he was about 65. So he wouldn't have wanted to play me. And he didn't challenge me the way Bobby Riggs did. So, yes.
Can you give me a kind of a fondest memory from when you were on tour, and maybe also the biggest disappointment?
The biggest
disappointment.
What was
memory?
Fondest memory.
Okay.
Memory.
Well, all right. You talked about Forest Hills, and I remember Forest Hills well, because that was before the time that everybody knows the U.S. Open at Flushing Meadows. But Forest Hills was the Nationals. It was the amateur time, and, you know, as I mentioned, '68 was the first year that open tennis came to and you had mentioned that there were no ball girls. You wanted to be a ball girl. And but anyway, going back to that, I think probably losing to Margaret Ford, that killed me. You know, I mean, I was in the finals, and I think it was my chance to probably win, and then I, next year I lost to Billie Jean, so, you know, so those were my two bad memories in Forest Hills. I mean, I got to the finals, not bad, but I quite didn't get over that hump.
How about a fondest memory?
Fondest memory.
Yeah. My fondest memory, I guess it would be winning Wimbledon with Billie Jean in 1967. I think that was a great moment, you know, because I was still very, very young and new on the tour, and so, you know, you hear so much about Wimbledon, and it's such a, you know, the atmosphere is unbelievable. It still is. I mean, I go back and, you know, that center court, even though I don't walk and play on that center court anymore, but tradition and all those wonderful players that have gone before, you know, when you think of all that and you're standing on that court, it's very awesome, very special.
Bruce,
yes.
Back in the early 70s, there were quite a few players of Virginia Slims, like from France, Spain, Thailand, and now we get a lot from Eastern Europe, Germany, and so on. How did they integrate with them? Would they bring into America, or America encourage them over here?
Well, when the Virginia Slims started, that was the only professional tour at that particular time that started
in the world.
I mean, there were still tournaments, and there was probably prize money, but not very much in Europe, because in Europe you had the double standard as well. They thought more about men than they did about women. And, you know, obviously we're starting to change that with Gloria Steinem and, you know, Women's Live and all that, and our Virginia Slims tournament. So because we had all the prize money, those players came to the United States to play. So everything was Virginia Slims beginning in January, and it would run through the whole year. And we would stop to play, you know, the Grand Slam. We didn't even play the French, but we would play Wimbledon, and we would play the U.S. Open, but, you know, all the rest of the year would be Virginia Slims tournaments.
They must have liked it.
And they came and joined us. And the movie, as I said, did not necessarily follow a timeline. We started the Virginia Slims in 1970. In 1973, we started the Women's Tennis Association. And so they sort of put that together. And so that was a big deal, starting the association and bringing all international players together, because they always felt, well, you're only talking about American women. And so it was really a big deal to start the association, because that really paved the way for all the tournaments and the standard and the prize money, and gave us you know, a lot more power of being united. So. Yes?
I have two questions. The first one, were those skating tickets artistic license, or were those...
was, what?
Were those speeding tickets artistic license, or were those real?
Funny you should mention that. I don't remember getting any speeding tickets then, but I have gotten some a couple years into my, you know, this age.
Second question. I believe there was another kind of play on words, Battle of the Sexes in Los Angeles, where Billie Jean played Elton John.
I don't think she played Elton, but she did perform with him at Dodger Stadium in the 70s, like around 73, 74. And he did sit on her bench and during World Team Tennis, because World Team Tennis sort of came into the picture in 1974. That was a team concept by Billie Jean and Larry, her husband. So, you know, it still exists. For those that have watched team tennis, it's both men and women together, and that's what she's always felt, equality. And so it's World Team Tennis with both men and women. Yes, one in the back. You're going to have to yell.
Well,
Who spent a lot of time on Billie Jean's private relationships?
Pass it down, pass that question down.
And I'm wondering if you could, if you were all aware of what was going on in her private life.
Oh, Billie Jean King's love relationship.
Were you aware of the relationship?
Was I aware of it? Well, of course, yes. We were a very close-knit family. I mean, we traveled together. So, you know, you're in the locker room, and I think anybody that's been in sports or even in you know, a different field where you're very close to people, you're very aware of what's going on. And the movie portrayed Marilyn as a very nice person. I wish she would have been that nice because she wasn't. And for those, the second part, unfortunately, was the palimony suit when she outed Billie Jean. So I don't know whether some of you remember, and that's how we ended up with palimony. I think Lee Marvin, you know, and so that's what happened really with that relationship. So, like I said, this Marilyn that they portrayed was a very nice Marilyn. But yes, everybody was aware. But you know, it's like anything. People don't, you know, players don't talk about those things. So yeah, it's a family, you know. And during that time, let's face it, it's not the same the way things are now, where you can talk it more acceptable. And we were trying to start a circuit and fighting for women. And it was the kind of thing that would create a problem, a stigmatism, unfortunately. So all of that had to be very quiet. So there was a lot of pressure, as the film portrayed, when she's thinking about her relationship with a woman, and then her marriage, and then this most important match of her life, really, the Battle of the Sexes. It becomes a very difficult moment for her. And a lot of pressure because she's juggling that situation, and she's got the media, and you know, you're trying to, you know, and she was the kind of person who was very, very honest. I mean, you know, if she found a $100 bill, you know, just on the street, she'd try and find, you know, somebody whose bill, whose money is it? I mean, you know, and I would look at her and like, it's mine now, you know. I mean, you know, she came from middle America, and I came from the other side of the tracks. So, you know, it was a little bit different. We were like night and day, but we got along, and you know, so, yeah, she was, but she was very honest and true to herself. And, you know, now she would tell you, of course, she could talk about it. She has her partner, you know, her relationship, and, you know, she's very, very honest about that, but it's just a sign of the times. The 70s were a tough time.
Oh, I
what?
So how long the relationship will last?
With Marilyn?
Yeah, well.
About a year. Yeah, as long as that movie, just about. Yeah, and of course they portrayed that she cut everybody's hair, but she did not.
Oh, that's
well, I mean, she cut my hair every once in a while, and some of the others. But yeah, that would have been quite a luxury. But, but we did travel very much that way, you know, from city to city, and we all look forward to being with one another, and we all practice together, even if we beat one another or play one another, we help one another. It was that kind of a sorority, let's say, that we established. That's why we're still very, very close. We just saw one another. The original nine was at the Los Angeles premiere a week ago. And so we all got together and talked and watched the movie and, you know, enjoyed and talked the same way. Well, do you remember that? Or, yeah, that was me and that was you. And, yeah, so it was a great time, I've got to say, you know, in the 70s, you know, to have been a part of this movement that changed, you know, women's tennis and changed sports and changed a lot of things in society. So, kind of proud of that. I may not have won my Wimbledons and singles and majors, but, you know, I'm proud that I was one of the pioneers of women's tennis with Billie Jean, who led, you know, the movement. It's great.
Are you originally from the Bay Area?
What?
Are you originally from
the Bay Area? Yes, I was born and raised in San Francisco.
Oh,
played tennis at Golden Gate Park.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. I moved down here because it was so cold there.
I went to
George Washington High School, and I remember in the 60s, you know, when you had the font and you wrapped your hair and you sprayed your hair. And, oh my God, by the time I got to 36th Avenue and that fog hit my hair, it was like, you know. So, yeah, it was.
That's why I lived down there.
Yeah.
Are you all pleased, you and the other eight? Are you all pleased with the way that the
I think most of us, yes, we were so pleased that Billie Jean really pushed to have the original nine. You know, it really made a great feeling to be able to see yourself and, you know, and if people ask me about Natalie Morales and how did I feel about looking at myself, and I thought, yeah, she was very attractive. She had very thin legs and much taller than I, and I would like that much better. But I'm sure I was a better tennis player. But she did a very good job on it, and I thought the filmmakers did a great job of bringing out what it felt that circus atmosphere, you know, celebrities, cameras, media, tennis fans, everybody was there, and it was so much fun, you know, to sort of be a part of that excitement. Of course, I did the TV, and I was stuck with Howard Cosell. Yes, he was the life of the party for ABC, Wide World of Sports. And, you know, everybody talked about how did he feel when he draped his arm around and he was kind of chauvinistic. Yes, he was. And, you know, he didn't know a thing about tennis. And probably was my biggest debut on television because at least 70 million people all over the world watched it, 30,000 in the arena. I mean, really, if you were there, you would remember the feeling. It was electric, really electric, and I don't think this could ever, I know it will never be duplicated. This was one of a kind, only for the 20th century.
Did you have individual coaches, each of you, ladies?
Did I have individual coaching? My dad got me started in tennis. So, no, I didn't really have individual. I mean, when I played doubles with Billie Jean, I learned a lot because she was very serious about her tennis. I was very talented and young, so I needed experience, and she kind of schooled me with how to train, how to work hard, how to, you know, get to where I was going. And so I would say most of the technique and the beginning was from my dad. I was a pretty natural athlete, so a lot of things came easy. They don't warrant repeating, but anyway, she said, what do I think about McEnroe's comments about challenging Serena? I think it's silly. I mean, you know, we can never reproduce this King and Riggs match. It will never have the same meaning. Well, I don't know about that. I don't think so. I mean, you know, and again, we go back to apples and oranges and what Billie Jean had said and what we believed in. We're entertainers, you know. A guy singing versus a woman singing. I mean, what are you going to say? The guy's better than the woman? I mean, if you like the women better than the guy singing, you know, it's apples and oranges. It's all a matter of who's entertaining. Who do you want to see? I mean, do you want to see Iris Williams or do you want to see Elton John?
Me!
Right, there we go. So, anyway, a couple more in the back, yeah? But you gotta yell.
What was Margaret Court's reaction after Billie Jean King? What was
Margaret Court's reaction after Billie Jean King won?
I don't know. I don't even know where she was because she was not playing the tournament. We were playing the Virginia Slims Tournament in Houston while Billie Jean
was playing the Battle of, you know, because there was a tournament going on. She was playing. And as a matter of fact, after she finished the Battle of the Sexes, I beat her. That was about the only time I beat her. But anyway, I don't know. But I mean, you know, they portrayed her pretty much as she probably was. You know, we were good friends, but she had her feelings about, you know, what was going on, and she didn't much care about women's movement and us fighting, because she really didn't join us. She and Virginia Wade, Yvonne Goulin, and Chris Elrick joined the USDA, which was a tour separate from Virginia Slims in 71. And eventually, so that was Billie Jean, myself, and Carrie Reed, and, you know, the other players, and eventually we were doing so well that the USDA decided that they were going to stop, and the other girls had to join us. So yeah, they decided they wanted to go against the Virginia Slims, but they were losing out on it. So anyway, so any other questions? But anyway, I thought the movie was great, and I hope that others would go and watch it. I think Billie Jean probably feels very proud about the movie. I know she's watched it at least a half a dozen times. And she's done a lot of publicity. She's been all over talking about it. But I know that she feels very proud of the moment and what it represented, because it did represent a lot to women. And, you know, again, there's a lot to be done still, and I hope that we will continue fighting for equality. Sorry, guys, but that's what it's all about, and that's, anyway. But I enjoyed watching it, and every time I watch it, I get to learn a little bit more, I get to hear a little bit more, so it's, yeah, different. Yes?
Did the makers of the movie come to you for any advice or any consulting?
No, they didn't come to me for advice, but they obviously saw the original, you know, Battle of the Sexes, because they had a lot of it. I mean, you know, they had a lot of it right. I mean, all the costumes and everything, unbelievable.
Well, the casting,
you know,
was,
and I thought the casting was excellent.
Just,
you know,
amazing. Yeah.
Yeah, Larry King was great.
Yeah. Awesome. You know, we went home and watched the stuff on YouTube after the movie, and
it was like the same.
Yeah. Carolyn, Ben,
yeah.
Bobby Ray.
Amazing. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, great. Anyway, I want to thank all of you for being here.
Thank you.
And Layton, yeah, for doing a great job. You pulled this together in 4 days. The October 28th Purple Room. Iris Williams will croon a tune or two, right? Great. Or three or four, actually. Yeah. Anyway, thank you very much.